Hey everyone, Justin here. Oh, uh-oh. Better get him to a hospital stat. Any fans of medical shows here? You know, like Chicago Med or Grey's Anatomy? Maybe you think you could do that too. If so, stay tuned as we find out what working in an emergency room is really like. An injured patient grimly clinging to life while paramedics rush them into the emergency room. We've seen it so many times before on TV and movies. In real life, it's not always that way. Dr. Jonathan Mcgee is an associate program director at Christiana Care Hospital in Delaware. He tried teaching before becoming an emergency physician.
I ended up actually graduating graduating college with a degree in biology, but ended up teaching both middle school and high school for about 5 years.
That teaching experience also proves very useful in his current position. As associate program director, he splits his time between clinical work and teaching and supervising residents. A resident is a physician who is out of medical school and is now receiving training in a specialized area, like emergency medicine.
We have dedicated didactic days, you know, every Thursday and Friday. So, you know, part of my job is just what it was, you know, way back when I was teaching school. So it's good. It's come full circle a bit. So
Doctors Zachariah Brown and Jessica Beedle are two residents who work with Dr. Mcgee. Like Dr. Mcgee, Dr. Brown also thought about becoming a teacher.
And so I was thinking about maybe I'll just be a teacher, do science teacher, do something along those lines in like high school. But then the more and more that I looked into medicine, I was like, oh, I'm gonna go for this.
Dr. Beedle has been interested in health sciences since high school. That interest grew in college, where she also learned about its challenges.
I think the application process, it can be pretty daunting, having to apply to a lot of different medical schools because the acceptance rate isn't, you know, that it's pretty competitive. The pathway to becoming, you know, an attending physician, which is kind of the end result of all of this education and everything, is you go to, you know, undergraduate, get your degree, and then you go to medical school, and then you start residency. So intern year is essentially the beginning of residency.
It's like starting the whole application process again. I think this one has a little bit more nerves involved because it's what you're doing for the rest of your life.
Then comes the interview process, where a candidate may have to travel to many different hospitals all across the country in order to continue their training in a specific branch of medicine. This can be costly, time-consuming, and stressful. Usually, candidates have to pay for their own travel, lodging, and meals. But it's also an important step in order to ensure that the applicant and the hospital are a good fit for each other.
At the end of all of this, I'll be board certified in emergency medicine, and he'll be like double board certified in emergency medicine and also family medicine.
They do rotations in other departments connected to emergency work, such as the ICU. As you medical show fans probably know, that stands for intensive care unit. But emergency medicine has a special place in the residents' hearts.
And for me, once I did my emergency medicine rotation, I knew that that's what I wanted to do because I really liked being there. And then the shifts went by very quickly, and I was excited to come into work. And I think that's a good sign when you're in medical school that that's going to be the right path for you.
So emergency medicine, I think, is a very interesting aspect of medicine because you're dealing with the critically ill patients. But you really have to think. I think I like the aspect that you're kind of a little bit of a detective in trying to figure out what's going on with the patients.
Dr. Mcgee explained the process that all residents have to go through.
You know, what they do in terms of their progression through residency is what's called sort of graduated, basically responsibility. So, you know, as an intern, they're heavily supervised. And then as a second, third, fourth, and fifth year, they're sort of less supervised. You know, they have a little bit more autonomy and a little bit more freedom to kind of do the things that they, you know, need to do and potentially want to do for patients.
Residents receive a training license through the state and hospital system. This training license allows them to practice medicine under supervision within that state. If they wanted to practice in a different state, they would have to apply for a new license there. Interns and residents are usually funded by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, or CMS. According to ZipRecruiter, as of September 2021, the majority of CMS teaching residents' annual salaries falls somewhere between $25,500 and $65,000. In Delaware, it's somewhere in the middle, $45,000, according to Dr. Mcgee. With time, though, that number could jump up significantly.
Generally here on the East Coast, as a starting emergency medicine provider, you could expect to make maybe, you know, anywhere from $250,000 to $300,000 a year, which, you know, for a new graduate is, you know, comparatively, you know, making 45 and then jumping, you know, somewhere to 250, 300 is a nice little jump.
A physician's malpractice insurance may be covered, at least in part, by the group or hospital they work for, but not always.
Sometimes your salary might be a little higher, but it's a little bit higher because they expect you to go out and get your own malpractice insurance.
Working in a hospital, especially in an emergency room, can be stressful.
I would have to agree. I think the biggest thing would probably be going with the flow. Because again, things can change very quickly in the emergency department.
I know that that's a big risk that a lot of people think about is burnout, and it's pretty high in medicine in general, and in particularly in emergency medicine because of how fast-paced things are.
At Christiana, they offer time off and wellness programs to help prevent burnout. But nothing could have prepared the staff for the sudden emergence of the COVID-19 pandemic.
And then there was a lot of confusion. It's a brand new thing that's going on. There's new research that's constantly being made about it. And so you're trying to adapt and basically keep up with the new research as well.
Changes had to be made to the hospital's procedures as more was learned about COVID. Those changes extended into the residents' home lives.
I'd had to take off my shoes. I'd put them in my trunk of my car. And then immediately when I'd get home, I'd let her know, hey, I'm coming home. And so then I'd just take off all my scrubs, put them directly into the wash machine. And then usually I'd jump into the shower too as well right after that.
Just making sure, you know, it was scary because you didn't, you know, you don't want to get your family sick. Like, obviously there's risks when you're going into medicine, but the worst thing, you know, with all these people that we were seeing kind of dying around us, we didn't want to make our family sick. And I think a lot of people in the healthcare community felt the same way and kind of were taking those similar precautions.
There's danger and risk involved in emergency medicine, but there's also great fulfillment as well.
It's extremely rewarding. You know, I really like talking to patients, and when they're in the emergency department, it's one of the most kind of vulnerable times of their lives for a lot of people. And so it's a privilege to take care of people when they are, you know, looking for help and when they don't necessarily know what to do.
If you want to help at the ER, but not necessarily as a physician, Dr. Brown suggests these jobs.
There's a clerk who does the big thing with answering the phone calls. So she's part of the team that helps. There's the patient techs who are involved in transporting the patients as well as making sure with the room assignments. Some emergency departments also have medical scribes that work with the actual doctor themselves, and they write the notes as the day and the shift is going on.
Some final thoughts on a career in medicine.
If you're interested in medicine, definitely try to get involved in things early on. Like, obviously in high school, if you want to try to do some volunteering in the hospital, that's always a good start. Focusing on your grades is a big thing.
Even if your grades aren't so great, that's not necessarily a deal breaker.
You can still become a doctor. Just because you got bad grades in high school doesn't mean you can't get there. because I have a friend that went through that path. So don't lose hope if you're not doing well in high school.
I don't expect anybody in high school to know what they want to do for the rest of their lives. I mean, I certainly didn't. But at the same time, like, if you know that medicine is something you clearly want to do, I mean, there are obviously some very clear-cut pathways sort of ascribed, you know, by various colleges and universities, you know, throughout the country that will sort of, you know, put you in, you know, in the right direction.
A lot of food for thought, even if you don't go down this specific career path. Thank you, Drs. Mcgee, Brown, and Beedle, for your insight into working in an emergency room.